Yo, what's up? Welcome back. Rogue's Passage Podcast, Episode 6. In this episode, we sit down with the whole crew plus our guest, Emery. We got a couple games in that day with her, and we even got to try out a spicy little commander variant that she suggested to us minutes before we rolled the dice, and I hope you guys enjoy. There is a small caveat. We did have, for some reason, small audio issues with the recording, but luckily we had the GoPro recording as well. I just decided to fade between the audio to salvage the conversation because I thought it was a great episode. Sometimes just gremlins just get in and just nibble on the wires while you're trying to make content, and sometimes you just gotta roll with it. I really appreciate everybody that's been supporting so far. We'll see you guys at the face-to-face tour in Calgary, September 29th to October 1st. We're going to be there representing, and I'm going to try my hand at competing in Pioneer. We talk about all that in this episode. I hope you enjoy. I just wanted to say, give us a break on the audio. Sorry, sometimes stuff happens, but I tried to smooth it out. I hope you enjoy the episode. We'll see you guys later.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Rogue's Passage Podcast. I'm Brando. Here's Brady.
Hi.
This is Tanner.
The cherry.
And our lovely guest, Emery.
Hello, hello, hello. Genuinely honored.
Absolutely. Yes.
Heck yeah.
You are unblockable.
How's everybody doing?
Tifa, I'm Sony Bay.
How's everybody doing today?
Vibin.
Fantastic Sunday.
Right on.
Yeah.
Right on.
I'm doing great. We got a couple games in today. We will, second half of the podcast or wherever we go, we're going to talk about this cool format that Emery introduced us to that we played a one game of.
Mm-hmm. Heck yeah.
To start out.
Yeah, you'll all see we've got a game coming out, or this podcast will come out before the games. The week after you guys see all of this is going to be the games with Emery. I'm not here for those games. I just rolled up to come to
beginning of season two for us, I do believe.
Brando was apparently too busy for us.
He's got stuff to do.
I work a job, like most millennials. So I'm sorry that...
Wait, most millennials are working?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
We're saved.
Yeah.
I thought we were all too entitled and lazy.
No. We're not entitled and lazy anymore. It's that we spend all of our money on avocado toast.
And we're in our 30s. So
and like $8 grasp. Coffees.
Give me some grasp of reality. Right on. All right, good.
Indeed. Well, today, on this fine day, I guess we haven't been able to really unveil the fact we're going to be at, I guess we did mention it in the last podcast episode, but we're going to be at the September 29th to October 1st Calgary date of the face-to-face games tournament tour.
Super exciting. Yeah. Super exciting.
And our focus of being there, which I'm excited and nervous about, I'm going to pop my actual cherry in tournament magic, and I'm going to register 75 cards in a Pioneer tournament and see how I do over the weekend.
And bro here's going with two yes men who are we're going to be going around being as much personality as we can, interviewing people when applicable, not making too much of a nuisance of ourselves, and just really have a good time, I think, you know?
Heck yeah. And are we going to have any of our merch available?
Yes.
We're not going to have big supplies, but...
It looks like what we're going to do right now is we're going to order 12 of our hoodies.
Just to start.
And we will have them before we go to the tour. So while we're there, if you're watching this, I hope
merch.
If you guys want a hoodie, they're going to be sweet.
Yeah, first come, first serve, because there's not
going to
be a lot of them.
First come, first serve, we're limited options for the first batch that we have here. If it's popular, we'll probably have a more continued supply from that. But aside from this, we have our baby batch on the horizons. Very exciting.
Yeah, but I'm gonna do the proper hero's journey.
Yeah.
The bird leaving the nest.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to register a deck against a random group of competitive strangers. And, Pioneer is something that I built a deck... Before the pandemic started, I built the Boros Feather deck, and I built it, I sleeved it up, I built my sideboard, and I wanted to go compete in Pioneer, and then the world ended. Briefly.
We don't talk about the bad times.
The dark times. The virus. So I never actually got to I was really excited. I wanted to play Pioneer. Mm-hmm. And now that this is happening and one of the events is Pioneer, it's not the main event. I did not qualify to compete in the main tournament circuit.
Yep.
This is just going to be sort of for fun, but I'm still going to be a prep against some sweaty Pioneer players.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be playing
because I don't want to spend too much money on my deck. I'm playing mono red burn wizards package.
Yep.
What?
The cards, most of the cards are in the mail. I got to try and practice and get like some reps with this deck.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be we're going to do a vlog series of episodes of what it's like for me going in and playing competitively for the first time and mm-hmm. probably getting my teeth smashed in nonstop. Mm-hmm. But yeah. It's going to be fun because I'm actually, I feel like we should do a bingo card.
Oh, I completely
agree. All of the potential things that I could run into. Like one of them is going to be like the dude who just like bullies me.
Yeah.
All the way through the match.
Oh yeah.
Ask me to concede. You know, yeah. like there's that type of archetypical magic.
The famous the guy who I drove 15 hours for this and I've lost.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what exactly. you should do? Mind game kind of thing. We'll get you we'll print out a nice little actual bingo card with everything printed on it, sort of thing. But you bring it to the table playing.
And so
that as soon as the guy's just like, oh, are you gonna concede on that? You're just like,
yeah, excuse me.
You don't even acknowledge him, you just give him like a
cross off of things. Like, what was that? It's like, oh, I'll tell you later.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like having a dice next to your table and you just tick it up every once in a while. Exactly. Like the misplaced dice.
No reference, no context. Be like, oh, you're at 10 now. You just like, leap from like 10 to 20. They're like, what the fuck does that mean?
This reminds me of something that makes me so happy. It is no longer called this. There was a podcast called Scry Me a River.
Oh, yeah.
Best fucking podcast name ever.
Yep.
Riley Knight, one of the guys who's usually like the coverage broadcaster. And Dennis Straniak, he was Channel Fireball. He works for Channel Fireball. Anyway, the two of them, they had this segment on their podcast where they would invite people on to talk about their magic power plays, things that they would do in competitive situations to try and get in their opponent's head. And one of the ones that I loved so much was that they would always let their opponent put their play mat down first, mm-hmm. and then they would put theirs down, and they would always put it an inch over top of theirs. And if they adjusted it, they would put it back, and it would try and like be in conversation to try and like, and then just keep doing it. And there was another one. So Louise Scott Vargas, like Hall of Fame Magic player,
LSV.
Yeah, LSV, the biggest troll probably in the Magic universe. He is a Hall of Famer, mm-hmm. like Pro Tour winner. He's been in the Magic scene for like as long as John Finkel, mm-hmm. right? And like Kai Boudé. He has a power play that he does where he consistently will go and register in the pro tour.
Yeah.
And he will play against people. He will not bring a mat and he will not bring dice or tokens. And he will always ask his opponent if he can use their dice. And it's such a weird flex because he's like the type of person that's so like decorated.
Yeah.
But he like...
I would just say no. Right? Oh, I'm really sorry. You've come all this way for this? I'm sorry, bro.
But everybody he plays against is always just like, oh my God, it's Louis Scott Vargas.
Really, if you do that, he's won.
Yeah.
There's no winning in this scenario. The only way to win is if you know you're going against him to bring dice that you've bought specifically for him, give it to him as a gift and be like, I knew I was going to play against you. I'm prepared. That's the only way to come out on top of the situation, I think.
My other favorite one was, it was another Hall of Famer. In the original Magic starter decks, like Alpha, Beta, Revised, it came with a little fold-out paper thing with the rules of Magic.
Yeah.
And so like these pro players, they would pass the turn and then they would go over and they would fold it out and they would be like, okay, so there's a second main phase. There's a second main phase. And they would start reading.
Do you actually, Tanner, do you recall, you were sitting there with me when we were watching it on YouTube, but it was when Guilds of Ravnica, it was the Aurelia print at the time, and we were watching it on YouTube, this guy. Oh, I'm sorry.
That was Louis Scott Vargas, the pen trick?
That was him. Was it him? And he was just like, I'm just going to go reach for my mana, and he went to go like, oh, and then literally like, my buddy was like, no, retracted immediately.
So what he did.
Whole play was fucked up.
This is one of my favorite moments in like live coverage Magic, because Marshall Sutcliffe is the... LSV and Marshall Sutcliffe are the two hosts of Limited Resources, and Marshall was like commentating on that, so they're like good friends. And Marshall saw it coming. He had a Legion's. Is it Legion's Landing flips into?
It flips into
the backside, which is able to tap three to create a vampire token.
Yeah.
And he had four mana available, and the guy was attacking. So Louis Scott Vargas had a Settle the Wreckage in hand. Instant speed exile all attacking creatures, right?
Yeah.
And he didn't want to telegraph that he had Legion or Settle the Wreckage in hand.
Yeah.
So while the guy was trying to figure out whether or not to attack, Louise reached over to grab the vampire token, and he kept like gesturing to grab the vampire token to essentially like try and get make him think that this is the line that he's taking is
yeah.
the vampire token.
Yeah.
So like leading the witness, right? Yeah. He like grabs the vampire token and like fakes it a couple times and the guy like taps to attack.
Yeah.
And he like slams the settle the wreckage to exile his creature, won the game on the spot. It's so good.
Heck yeah. I do that all the time, to be honest. I'm always fiddling with
You do that a lot with Henzi.
Yeah. I always fiddle with tokens. I'll take one specifically and like set it to the top and people are like side-eye it and be like, oh.
Yeah, it's the pump fake.
I was like, I do it with the battles now. I love it. Because I always take the flip side cards. They're always in the stack of like tokens or stuff under my commanders. I've done it like twice now with the battles where somebody's been like, oh, he's going to play a battle. And it's like, nope. No, I'm just going to field wipe or something.
It's hard. The battlefield triggers that do it for me because you say, you know, does it resolve? Or you look at something specifically, you point it out and you'd be like, and you cast it and you say, does it resolve? And then you go for the thing that you really want.
Exactly.
And
it's perfect. Yep.
Magic is fun.
That's so much fun.
So in regards to this bingo card, I got to put together like the potential things that I think I'm going to encounter. Mm-hmm. Number one is Shieldred the Apocalypse.
Oh, yeah.
My deck that I'm building. One? No. Well, actually, you have two, right?
I do. So, I have one that's foil and I have one that's in Phyrexian.
So I'm conflicted right now with, do I stay the course of the deck that I've chosen? Or do I pivot to Rakdos midrange and just try to borrow as many cards as possible? Because I can't afford that deck. That's like a $700 or $800 deck.
What do you need, babe? What you got? You got three rows.
Oh, we're talking like four copies of Fable of the Mirror Breaker and Shieldred the Apocalypse and like
I got two copies of Shieldred.
I got one of the Fables.
So I got you halfway there at least.
I do need to borrow, even regardless of what I'm playing, the Den of the Bugbear.
Yeah.
Like, and if anybody wants to sponsor this
I have one of those.
Peon.
I have one.
Okay.
Did that go up in price or something?
I think they're like $10 each. So
you want a play set of them.
Yeah, and for me to build this deck, I have a wife and child that will murder me if I spend any more money on this deck.
Yeah.
I've currently spent about $125 building this deck. So that's pretty cheap for a Pioneer deck.
Share the list. I'm sure the two of us here will be able to help you.
Yeah. But anyway,
talk to me about a little bit of it. I think I might have Den of the Bugbear. I don't know.
I have one guaranteed.
Yeah, I have to do that. I still think that you should at least put them in the sideboard potentially. Chandra's Incinerator.
Yeah. That might be.
Like it's just, especially if you know that you can swap it out for like some of the wizards, like creatures, where it's just like, okay, you know you can swap it out. You're keeping in your burn spell sort of thing. Chandra's Incinerator, by the way, is an amazing card. It costs X less. It's 6 to cost. 1.
5 and a red. Yeah.
5 and a red. It costs X less, where X is the total amount of damage.
Non-combat
damage.
So burn damage.
That's been dealt to your opponents that turn.
It's a 6-6 trample, I think.
6-6 trample or something like that. It's pretty close to that. But then it has a secondary effect where as soon as you ping somebody for damage, it also deals that much damage to one of their creatures. Which in a mono red burn deck
could be good against a creature matchup.
At least sideboarding it, having the three in there, because you said you have two. You can absolutely borrow mine. Just have the three in there, just in case. It'd be like, you know, you're gonna need the two ping.
Yeah, I mean, this is gonna be. It's wild. It's fun thinking about a competitive environment and trying to like wager on what you might encounter.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to respect the meta decks, right? Like right now, I think mono green Nykthos. Like Devotion is like one of the big beaters. There's Lotus Field combo. There's Rakdos midrange, and there's a number of other things, right? Like Mono Red Wizards, the one that I'm looking at playing is not. It's a budget deck that won a league, and because of that, there was a bunch of content creators that were like, "Yo, this deck went 5-0 last weekend. We're gonna try it out," and it kind of sucks, but we're gonna punch up.
Yeah. I mean, that might be exactly what gets you through, though.
Yeah.
Because everybody studies the meta when it comes to this stuff. And so when they take a look at those decks that are like, oh, they're performing well, but they're kind of crappy because everybody figures out the beat for them. So everybody's going to have steered into like, everybody would have steered into trying to beat that specific build. And then it's steering past that to build something that beats the build that beats what you built.
So here's the thing.
That's a tongue twister.
Shieldred is in a number of these meta decks, and it's a card that if it resolves, it like it gains 2 life a turn and drains me 2 life a turn basically at minimum. And it's a 5 toughness creature. Mono red burn, not easy to do that. So there's a spell that is likely. I might actually put 2 in the main board. It's called Roast. 1 in a red sorcery. It deals 5 damage to target creature without flying.
Yeah.
And it's like the only card that's reasonably costed that I can just tag Shieldred.
Yeah.
So this is where I'm at. I'm currently deck building. It's going to be wild. It's going to be also, so much fun.
It's also real ballsy getting on camera. We don't have like the biggest audience yet. Love all of you watching.
Oh, we got millions. What you talking about?
Everybody who is watching this, love you. You the real ones. I'm just going to laugh if one of the people who is watching this video right now turns out to be one of your opponents.
That's poetic justice.
I mean, poetic justice for sure, to be like, I watched your podcast. I know exactly how to beat you.
Not poetic justice, but you know, it's poetic.
You know, I think the best way to come out winning from this is to build a deck that you enjoy playing.
Yes.
So that either way, even if you don't win anything, you had a good time.
The friends you made along
the way. You got to live the expectations
exactly,
here.
Exactly, exactly.
So, yeah, in that regard.
No, if you don't win, you're not allowed to come back.
Oh my God, I'm going to get cut from the cast.
yeah, unfortunately. You can continue to, like, work on
Tanner,
tech.
You're an editor. That's all you are.
Yeah. You lose camera.
Fuck you.
If you lose your first match, you lose camera privileges for at least a month.
You're done.
Bag over my head.
Yeah. Next four episodes, you're out.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. I got a lot on my shoulders.
Come on, Wizards. I believe in you. I think
if you lose your second round, we take the house.
Yeah,
it's like a separate bingo card for like my match winnings.
Where we
it's
win.
Actually just our contract. To you. Yeah.
Hey, we wouldn't be rogues if we didn't try to swindle something off you.
It takes a soul to become unblockable.
Yes,
it takes a soul.
So yeah, we're gonna be at that. We hope anybody that's gonna be there come and say hi. We have I don't have one handy, I guess, but we have the little Rogues Passage proxies. That,
image prompt here.
Yeah.
Image prompt, do you want?
Come get free.
This is a Hubby Now
where I always do this and it's never exactly where my hands are. Like, the fuck are you guys are going to add it now to the exact space of my hands?
The YouTube people know. For the audio listeners, we will describe the card for you.
Oh, yes, our namesake. I agree, yes. Actually, speaking of our audio, on Spotify, I go to listen to our podcast on Spotify, it shows our video.
Yeah, I've been uploading the video straight to
Spotify.
That's
amazing. No, yeah. I love that. I never realized that feature was on Spotify. Yeah. I really appreciate it for that. Spectacular.
So yeah, come and find us. We're going to, if all goes to plan, we'll have our merch by then, right? We'll be wearing our Rogues Passage hoodies. Come and say hi.
It'll be obvious. You'll see our insignia on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're very nice hoodies.
They're
beautiful.
If you can't find us by the hoodie, then just listen for the crying and I'll be sitting in the corner.
Listen for the crying.
Put it on your forehead.
No, we good.
Yeah, that can't possibly cause any problems with the microphone.
Oh, no, it won't. It's just clipped on the metal on the side. We're fine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I guess on to our guest for our recording day today, Sunday of this day of our Lord.
Hello.
This is Emery.
On this day where we chose Jesus' life.
I am your Lord.
Yes, Jesus Christ today is our Lord and Savior. And to demonstrate all this, we have Emery.
I brought over today a lovely little deck that I put together after seeing a YouTube show called Shuffle Up and Play, if you've ever heard it. Mm-hmm. It's not quite the same caliber as this, but
they got like what 10 followers.
They're up and comers, a little bit behind us, I think. I certainly haven't fanboyed about the professor like 8 times on the channel so far. So
he's true. He's wonderful. We love him.
Yeah, we love him. He's a gem.
So this gentleman named Maldhound went onto the show, and he was showing off this deck called Treasure Cruise. Mm-hmm. And immediately, I was interested in it because it was kind of a supplementary thing to the rest of the game, and they were just playing regular old Commander. So it's a deck made of all sorts of mana rocks, swords, and curses as well. Mm-hmm. So you kind of have the deck in the middle, you kind of roll to see what cards you get from the top, mm-hmm. those go onto your battlefield, you get those potentially for free, you just pay mana to roll from the top of it. Mm-hmm. We've all played it now at this point, we actually played a little bit earlier, and I think it's a really fun way to add to the game and make it so that it kind of balances things out for people. If you're not doing something, you have something to potentially do.
Balance is a very loose
potentially
word.
Potentially screw yourself.
Balance.
It's similar to Plane Chase in regards to the fact that there's a deck outside of the game that you can pay mana into manipulating.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I spent a lot of mana to curse myself today.
Yeah, it was beautiful.
And then the only thing that I got that was good,
sort of feast and famine.
It was your first, and that's what got you greedy, and then you're like, wait, I want to keep doing it.
Yeah, I did.
It
was the first free one, man.
Yeah.
And then Dylan went ahead and just destroyed it, and I was left with two curses, which actually really...
Didn't curse you too much. I think you only cast one time However,
I played turn three of rule law, and then his curse of the Forsaken Oath, I think it was, every time you would play his second spell and everyone beyond that, he gets two damage to his face. Didn't even matter.
And if anything,
Curse of Shaken Faith, thank you. And the only ones benefiting that literally was me and Dylan there for, I think, five.
And then there was a long... like period where nobody was even like thinking about the pile of pirate cards, because it was like we all had so much to worry about and not enough mana to worry about that deck, and it didn't come back until like the end of the game, right? Did we even roll? I guess
no, but you should have.
You should have.
You never know.
I had the one chance, because I didn't actually ironically roll a single freaking time. I was halted for the first five turns. I was like, okay, this is like plausible, but it was a lot to work around. And then when I finally had, I had two copies of Mirari's Wake, just vibing. I was like, I'm opulence, two Mirari's Wake on the battlefield. And I had a chance to do it at least twice. The two times I could have done it, at least the one turn, because I think I got pretty much killed two turns after, or maybe the next turn after that. It was beautiful.
Really popped off.
It was great.
You're gonna love to see it.
I'm gonna have fun editing this.
Absolutely.
But aside from that, it was great to. Dark, not great in that regard. It was an amazing game, seeing how it interacted. But the one player who didn't do it at all, obviously lost first.
So. Yeah.
Wait, you lost first? Were you?
I died first. I did incredible things. I came out of nowhere. I went from one to literally 100 million, and then I got.
Smacking the table.
So aggressive.
I'm divergent.
I played Nekusar in that game, and it's not a tuned Nekusar build. It's pretty bunk.
I apologize. I was so excited because I just love Nekusar.
Well, I did it because I was like, I don't want to just like replay another deck that I've played before.
Mm-hmm. And we all kind of wanted the three color thing.
Yeah.
You know,
and you guys were all like, I want to draw extra cards, and I just like couldn't. You had Grave Pact on the battlefield, so I was like, I don't know, I cast him once, he died.
I did.
Yeah, I couldn't really progress. I just, sometimes you have one of those commander games where you just...
It's defended me for a good amount of turns, and then it screwed Emery and, well, a little bit of the fairies.
A fair amount of damage, though. You did do a fair amount, you just didn't have a massive board state. You didn't really need it, I mean...
It wasn't much, but it was honest work.
A lot of damage.
Yeah.
Like I was down to 7 or 9 or something like that at the end of it. It was pretty crazy.
It was an interesting game, that's for sure.
It's explosive. Like the first time I played Henzi on the channel. I'm really
Keepers Creepers?
Yeah, I'm really thankful that I've got a little bit of redemption. He still didn't actually do much other than be a pest and blow stuff up. But the first game I played Henzi, I think it's like our second episode or something, I didn't do a damn thing that game. And Henzi's one of my best decks, and I don't think I did anything.
You didn't even make creatures cheapers.
No, I didn't.
It was his first intro. He's like, I'm playing Henzi. I make creatures cheapers.
I make my cheapers creatures.
I like that.
Yeah.
My brain works very good.
Oh, yeah. We're all heckin' smart.
Cheapers creatures.
Anyway, what do we want to talk about? Or what do we want to talk about? Now, like last time we did a podcast, we talked about all the cool releases that Magic was throwing out.
I was really excited, but we had a good 20 minutes talking about Doctor Who, I think.
A lot. Yeah, that was a good, strong
I'm still
section.
Really excited about that. I'm still incredibly excited about that, but we don't need to rehash any of that. If anything, I'm really excited about a lot of these new ones, expecting specifically the Country Western. I'm putting all my money into that.
Yeah.
Very, very excited with that,
So Wild of Eldraine. Out now. Go buy a box.
It's 2 days ago, right?
Yeah. Well, like 9 days once you're seeing this kind of thing.
Yeah.
I guess so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's fun. It seems a little underpowered and undervalued compared to some of the stuff. No. This is good. Underpowered and undervalued based off of what we've been seeing lately out of like the last like four, let's say four big releases out of Magic.
They did just have a Masters set though.
Exactly. Yeah. And I love it. It's like everything, even the, like the Commander deck sort of thing, both were going for 100 on release, which is like fantastic because each, right? Everything kind of came down with it. The flavor for it's fantastic. I guess... When we went to Eldraine last time, they had a cinematic for it, as they did for a while there. Or I guess they're still kind of doing it, but we didn't get one for this
think
Eldraine.
I think we did. I saw it come out a couple days ago, maybe. I didn't watch it. I saw a YouTube notification of the trailer for Wilds of Eldraine.
But we got, last time we went to Eldraine, we got, like a little animated teaser video sort of thing.
It was just Ashiok being weird and sexy.
No. It was two gingerbread. Ashiok. It was two gingerbread people on a date, kind of just being like little cutesy sort of things. And then I don't know if it was still when he's like cursed / corrupted. Garuk just boots his way in the door, walks over, eats like the guy gingerbread cookie or whatever. And then they had like the whole animation is just like the. I don't know if they're meant to be like gendered represented. The female gingerbread cookie gets fucking pissed at Garuk, and like that's what the rest of the little short is kind of like.
Yeah, doesn't she like dive at him like with the sword out?
Yeah,
no, this is the old one from years ago.
This
is
the old
one.
People got in a tiff. Yeah, people got in a tiff when they did that because I guess the animation was made after all of the cards had been designed and stuff. So they went out of their way to specifically print. What's her name?
Sir Ginger.
Sir Ginger.
Female cookie.
The female cookie who's just
super like, excited.
Lore. Good lore.
Which is so much super flavorful for what they're doing, and especially like all of the stuff that they've done
with food after Lord of the Rings, no less. This is incredible.
They turned a bunch
food
of
culture out the ass now
food
with Magic
creatures, which is so cool, especially with everything that they did at Lord of the Rings. Like food matters now. Way
really
more
does.
Than I thought it was going
it really
to.
Does. Well, it never did.
Yeah, the cool thing about this new Eldraine set is the fact that they did all like the sweets, like mm-hmm. the monstrosity, like sweet,
Candyland.
Like mm-hmm. yeah, it's yep. like horrific candy monsters that are mm-hmm. actually like foods that you can sack. Like
yeah.
Pat's Guillaume deck. Are you kidding me? What
oh,
the
I know,
things
right?
it's gonna? Shout out to Pat, by the way, one of our best players in our pod. He's savage. He's got a Guillaume deck that does way too much, and now he has way too much to play with.
Oh yeah.
It's too much.
Yeah, why would you play with your food?
Your food is amazing to play with. As a chef, I dare say. It's best when you do play with it.
Did you guys see the spoiled art? Well, I guess it's not spoiled season anymore for Korvald, new Korvald.
What?
Yeah,
oh,
I love
it.
I did.
It's tasteful.
Yeah.
What does
tasteful.
He do again?
They underpowered it as well. I'm like,
can you bring that up on the tablet? I just want to remind myself.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to be building him because you guys probably remember, or some of you do, I had Korvald mm-hmm. before. Which was like Treasure Tribal, mm-hmm. and it was super good, super spicy. Mm-hmm. People really didn't like playing against it, and I kind of stopped playing it for that reason. It was just too much.
Mm-hmm.
So now this is, I feel, the perfect opportunity to have a Korvald that's not
obnoxious. As aggressive.
Not too
crazy. Yeah, it's more expensive,
crazy.
Right? I believe it's 7 mana or something.
And it's fun and flavorful. I can rebuild the whole food tribal thing that I had with Asmorana, Mardukaitis, Dina Caldicar.
Yeah.
So now I think it's perfect for that. And... Yeah. I don't know if you guys have seen Godrick from the new set either. The
no.
little spoil. I'm pretty sure that's Korvald in disguise as a human.
Oh, that would be cool.
Ooh,
into Korvald.
I think you were correct.
That would be really cool.
Okay,
so one of the big things of note before you read this off, and we'll splash this on the screen just for its own little anecdote. I don't think this Korvald is better than the old Korvald.
No, absolutely not. No, they downpowered
it
tremendously.
Because you can play it actively and not have people be like,
but see, that's kind of the thing, though,
Korvald
right?
is hyper-competitive.
That's kind of the thing, though. It's
functionally
it's not,
way too competitive.
It's not even necessarily that. It's weird that they did it because he does cost more than the other Korvald.
Oh, totally.
But he's slightly worse than the other Korvald.
It's like a tower.
And as we've learned, and it's not going to be the same for
Someone's
every
got
time.
Haste, though.
Yeah, it's not going to be the same for every single time that people are playing Magic.
Yep.
But we just had Korvald. Go check out that episode right now. If you've got kill spells to keep Korvald off the battlefield, Korvald can't do nothing, son.
It's
really, hard in Jund to like protect against interaction. So yeah, I guess we'll read off here. This Korvald Gleeful Glutton. It is a 5 black, red, green. So 5, 6, 7, 8. Actually, I was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
This is an 8 mana creature that this spell costs 1 less to cast for each card type among permanents you've sacrificed this turn.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not even just sacrificing a bunch of tokens. It's you have to sack different types.
So well, artifact, creature.
This is kind of the thing, though, is we've entered the era probably 2 years ago where they've started mass print. Like, almost every set has something that has three different, two or three different types to it now.
Yeah.
Enchantment creature.
I'll finish reading this before we get too far into the weeds here. So it's Flying Trample Haste, which is like fast flamble.
Mm-hmm. Fast flamble.
That's what I call it.
Flamble heck.
Flamble.
And then this line is amazing. Whenever Korvold deals combat damage to a player, mm-hmm. put X 1/1 counters on Korvold and draw X cards, mm-hmm. where X is the number of permanent types among cards in your graveyard.
Yeah.
So once it's on the battlefield, once that engine's going, that thing slaps.
And that's max 9 at this point?
Well, yeah, you're never going to get that, but you're probably going to get 4.
Mm-hmm. If you run it as a pseudo self mill, self sacrifice deck, I don't think so. It's in the right colors with some of the stuff that we've been seeing for a lot of this like pseudo graveyard or pseudo token generation on death.
So what? Forgive me.
I want to make it.
I'm not a black green player.
I really am not.
Yeah.
What enables this efficiently in regards to sacrificing cards of multiple permanents?
Well, things with persist. Things with persist, you're gonna love.
No, I mean like there's got to be a card that says sacrifice X permanents.
Baba Yaga. Right? Baba Yaga was one that does it. So if you type sacrifice three permanents, it has to check for three different differences in the permanent types, and then you get to do some things. So you mill three cards.
Did you say Baba Yaga?
Baba Yaga. Yeah. You just draw. Yeah, Baba Yaga.
Oh, yeah, dude. You're fine. You sit down. We're John brothers over here. You sit down with us.
Isn't Baba Yaga what they call John Wick? The boogeyman?
It's a Eastern European Slavic. It's a titular one, actually. Baba Yaga is
kind of witch.
There's a couple variations if you want to get completely subtract. There's a few versions. There's one or there's several versions, but the most popular ones are an old witch literally just hanging out in this ginormous cauldron, floating around doing evil things, mm-hmm. and then there are the other versions are three sisters, which pertains to a lot of classic mythology. All around that area, three sisters, where they all kind of represent certain different things, and they're all, of course, kind of neutrally evil. Mm-hmm. Again, Baba Yaga is in for Slavic mythology, very evil, not a provider of knowledge and such, but at a cost almost guaranteeably, and apparently an eater of children, among other things, and inspire of many, many different mythologies when it comes to old crones and such.
I feel like there's a really big crossover when it comes to like ancient mythology and exactly those three. Like notions. This is an ancient entity that's gonna eat your children or kidnap your children and steal their souls. But it's also gonna give you like godlike knowledge. But also, it's like some kind of
demonology,
weird trickster.
The story of Mephistopheles.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah, my old Fosty boy.
It's always lovely to see how old mythologies kind of like interweave like that. Where what was the first? Where did some inspire the others?
I dare say it was Magic the Gathering.
Yeah. Yes.
I hate to always bring up everything about dragons and have everything come back to dragons. Oh, but dragons. The fact that there's different cultures
with
that
ginormous
all have
reptilians.
Different dragons that are all different in their own
ways. Well, that pertains to a lot of, there's like a lot of support because science back then sucked. So whenever anyone saw something, they thought it was a dragon. It was likely maybe the dying end of a species that was incredibly Jurassic.
Well, but you're telling me that and stuff.
In our world today, you can go, especially we live close to Drumheller, Alberta, which is a burial ground of incredible fossils for dinosaurs.
Yeah.
You're telling me that an ancient culture dug up like a Tyrannosaurus Rex or an Albertosaurus or like, you know, one of these and like sees the skull and the teeth and everything and they don't, that's got to be a really like this existed, and of course,
I do believe there's ancient fossils found by ancient peoples that have their own.
Yeah, are two specific things that go into this. Just in sort of take what I'm about to say with a grain of salt, because a lot of this comes from like the access of like downloading YouTube videos into my brain.
Because we Google
years.
Smart around here.
So one of the big things, and this is kind of like side anecdote, but a cool little factoid for you: the mythology of unicorns has an answer.
I love it.
It's the rhinoceros.
Oh, I thought it was that Tom Cruise movie, Legend.
I mean, that
Peter
too,
S. Beagle?
Tim Curry, you know?
So it's kind of been figured out through like a bunch of like dated documents and all this stuff of just like talking about like some species. Like, it's not guaranteed that, this is like where the myth of unicorn kind of came from. But it's like old documents that were like documenting. It's like, this sort of like tall bipedal creature that has a like horn coming out of it, blue.
I see. Game of telephone almost.
Game of telephone. And so like you're talking about like you take the knowledge of that or the story of that to a continent that doesn't have rhinoceros. What exists there? Okay, so you've got like your cows or something. You've got your horses. Well, it's like different animals, different places.
Brain's so tilted.
No, it's almost.
I got something to debate to this. Yeah,
it's basically been come to understood that what has been seen as the unicorn was just a rhinoceros that got mistaken for a horse.
I do believe that the unicorn myth comes from Arthurian legend, and now Arthurian legend is the farthest place from Africa that I can think of.
Exactly. What's the time frame of Arthurian legend?
Arthurian is, we're just talking about like...
We're talking about Eldraine. We're talking about...
Yeah.
We're talking like old school...
Yeah, this is where it ties back to what we were actually...
Arthurian legends, a lot of them... Now, I'm not a historian in this case, or a mythologist, but there are some legends that are purely colloquial, you know, like regional only. Mm-hmm. And...
Here, I'll take one of those.
Take him away. Sorry,
Save
Bay.
Save him.
Give me Cloud.
The unicorn... has always been, to my understanding, like I think Gaelic or something along those, like in origin. So, and as far as I'm aware, it always was, its classic mythological representation was a vestige or vestive pure virgin would be gallivanting through a field or a forest somewhere, just being gay and pretty and beautiful and pure. And a ginormous masculine male horse with a horn on its head would show up. That's where that ends for me in terms of that. But in terms of the crossover for some mythology mixing up for things that were being mistaken, I don't know how Arthurian legends, or in this case, I think I'm also fucking this up completely, mythology pertaining to the British, like Isle, you know, that whole area of the world, how it could be, how a rhino can misrepresent that. You know, the etymology of that, I don't know how that...
Because Brady, it's the game of telephone. I'm gonna describe something like, right, pretend you've never seen, you don't know what a rhinoceros is,
ancient
right?
Brits not but, knowing ancient but, African, I don't know.
No. Hear me out, right? You have never seen, nor do you know what a rhinoceros is, okay? That's just, you don't...
It's easy to imagine, though, a monster with a horn coming out of its head if you've seen one
creature
with a horn.
But you're not talking about a monster. I'm gonna come to you talking about the story of a bipedal creature that runs really fast.
But why does that have to be a rhino? Why does it have to be any creature? Anyone can just imagine the one time an inbred animal.
They have zebras in Africa.
Well, even just like a goat back in the day may have been born with one horn.
You're backstepping on that, right?
Going back the one goat back in the day that fucked its mother, right? And you know,
that's our show.
The goat that birthed then a one-horned goat creates all sorts of mythology. My debate is, how does Africa have to be the point of that, as opposed to what could have been just a much more simpler Occam's razor example of poor goats done fucked each other too much. You know, that's what I mean.
How did we get here from Corvo?
I get where you're coming
Unicorns.
From. But the thing with the dragons is, and the most important part, Chinese dragons versus Japanese dragons, there's similarities.
Yep.
Fair amounts of differences, but very, very similar, right? It's very worm-shaped. They've got arms coming out of different spots, right?
Yep.
For thousands of years, they did not have connection with each other.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, there was
that. But they still created things, right, that were very, very similar. Japanese, specifically, they didn't have any kind of connection to, like, Mayans and stuff, where they also had dragons in their culture. Mm-hmm. So there's actually this thing, and it's a psychological thing, where humans actually have this innate need to create dragons.
Mm.
These beasts that have long teeth, fangs, like claws, elongated necks, like they've gone into the actual science of why we think dragons are so cool and why every like human being needs to have this like almost like a god figure of some kind of sort looking up to dragons. And that is the reason why different cultures have them, even when they've had no actual connection between those cultures.
Obviously,
to explain it.
It's explained.
So there's half and half, right? Where you can have it where someone's describing something and they're just like, oh, that sounds like this. We don't have that here.
Yeah.
But there's also like an innate human need to create these things. And that's why dragons are cool.
I have two little anecdotes for that. The first of that is kind of still on the same... we're going to take this to ancient Egypt for a quick second.
Man who doesn't like Assassin's Creed crossover with magic...
it's coming. Assassin's Creed magic is coming. Yeah. It's real world in my
sorry,
magic.
I didn't mean to interject.
I'm so angry about that.
Ancient Egypt. So Cleopatra had a nice mighty reign over that land for a good long time.
Efficiency.
When she was in power, and like in rule of ancient Egypt, the pyramids were already like thousands of years old. And we're starting to get to this weird point where kind of akin to that, but kind of against what you're going off there. Nothing's really proven, but we're kind of getting to this point where it's seemingly understood that there might have been a global civilization way, 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 way back. And then whatever the heck happened, we still don't know. Well, history is lost to time sort of thing, where all of the world's cultures kind of like, it wouldn't have been an advanced civilization. It would have just been like, you know, wooden boats still being able to do mild trade along the coast, and then all of that being lost to time because of
who knows what. Was that one movie where it was like an apocalypse with just a bunch of dragons?
Fire in the Sky. No, not Fire in the Sky. That's
Rain of
alien.
Fire?
Rain of Fire,
Rain
yeah.
of Fire.
Fire in the Sky is
like
about
an ancient
alien
Rain of Fire kind
Maybe
of
that's
civilization.
What
Can we go there?
Without getting too ancient aliens about this, there's actually so much to support when it comes to mass extinction events over the course of everything that, you know, the more and more science keeps being uncovered about all this. Mm-hmm. There's still humongous, like, you know, archaeological, you know, buildings and places that are underwater and all these kind of things. So there's literally no written history about that. You're gonna think maybe okay, like this one ginormous city that's basically under a lake in China. Mm-hmm. Maybe that was the one area where, you know, the Mongols absolutely eviscerated this one area, and there's no proof of that happening either. Or, you know, like the way that Atlantis, by the way, referred to by Plato. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to knock on Plato too much, but when you have someone who is that credible for a lot of things.
Well, Plato was known for writing a lot of stuff that was inherently not true. Well, he's open for that. He was a
bit of a boob, too, wasn't he?
He was a storyteller.
A bit of a boob.
Well, Aristotle was diddling boys, but Plato was fucking, at least, was a big nihilist.
He was known to be both a storyteller and a philosopher. There was some of his stuff that was good, but then was it Plato that wrote the Odyssey? I might be really
I thought
wrong
Plato was
that.
Like the squishy
but
stuff.
Anyway,
there
has been enough history, and there's been enough like vagueness.
No,
you know,
we don't do that here.
There's been enough society, like, you know, there's enough archaeological evidence supporting all this stuff that we don't have any written proof of. Well, and when you think of things like the Great the Library of Alexander burning down, there's so much evidence or even potential cross-referencing even beyond that. Let's say history goes back even deeper than that, and we don't even have those tail-end representations of even deeper history from that era.
I have two...
I support this.
Dragons were real.
I think so.
I have two funny stories about that. The first, and I'll keep this one really short, back to ancient Egypt again. God, I love my Egypt. So there was a town in Egypt, ancient Egypt, we're again thinking Cleopatra-esque times, that since, in our current understandings, has just been lost to time. Yeah. Library of Alexandria kind
yeah,
of
exactly.
sense. But it wasn't that, like, oh, it got lost to time because of, like, burning of Alexandria or this or that. It's that because back in those days, there was clear markers, there was clear indicators, there was a clear path that you had to travel to be able to go from one town to the next or one city to the next. Because if you didn't, you were dead. It was not, oh, we have GPS or, hey, we have paved roads sort of things. Like, if you do not follow this specific path, you're lost, you're dead. That was the ancient world. So there's really known well town, like town, I can't remember the name of it. My brain always wants to say Perth, but I know Perth is an actual known city.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. But this town was lost to time. It was literally just along one of the major trade routes kind of thing. And they, a few years ago, I think, dug it up. And they're like, well, what the heck, blah, blah, blah. And they finally found it because nobody had ever thought to write down the directions to it. Because why would you?
It was like
get rid of GPS sort of thing.
Get rid of
our maps. And it's literally just like you're driving to Edmonton. Yeah, you're passing through Red Deer on the way there. Like, you could avoid it, but no, you're passing through Red Deer on the way there sort of thing. Why the heck would you need to know that if the only road goes through both areas? So it's like, absolutely, there's so much of our history that was lost. The second one, and this is really, really fun, it's a really pseudo-recent development in the world. Ancient Greece and Rome had a way of building concrete that was lost to the world for...
Oh, they did finally discover it?
They finally... It's not like news. It's probably like maybe about a decade
it's
old
limestone,
now.
It's limestone, isn't it?
It's limestone and specifically salt water.
because the whole thing was we didn't know how their architecture has stood for so long, how their dams lasted 1,000 years when our concrete half-steel ones crumple to dust in 50 years.
Well, ours is, it's because of the rebar. The reinforcement from steel rebar in our modern concrete sounds like a great idea.
Yeah.
It is the reason it will fail catastrophically when it rusts.
Yeah.
It splits it apart from the inside and pushes it apart.
Yeah.
Crazy. Concrete
in attune to that, part of that is they figured out the exact recipe, because again, it was never written down. It was one of those things where it's just like, why would you ever need to write
mortar?
Why would you ever need to write it down? Everybody knows that this is how you make concrete.
Yeah.
It was limestone. It was basically the same fundamentals of our concrete, but then it was specifically limestone. It was specifically seawater.
Yeah.
Because the limestone and the seawater mixed in such a way that they basically created pockets of fungus. So that as soon as a crack formed, the limestone would basically like be half melded with this fungus and it would fill the cracks. As soon as the rain got into those cracks, it would start to grow and fill until it couldn't. And then it was just sealed again.
And organic matter fills the...
It's specifically chunks of limestone, I think, is where instead of having it like really well mixed in, it's like chunks and pockets of it, so that when water goes into it, it like literally carries it throughout those cracks, and it's like self-sealing, self-healing.
Which is probably unintentional, right?
Aliens gave us that knowledge. It was aliens.
It was the
reptiles as well.
That came before us.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Like, come on, like the dragons, everybody knows dragons, because the lizard people rule us all.
I still
think
it was just a lot of dinosaurs still alive, and the dragon, the people just going batshit crazy over big lizards.
Oh, it's probable.
I think it's a fangirl thing. I really do. I genuinely feel it's like a psycho thing of like humans just really like
just
dragons.
A bunch of Taylor Swift fans without history.
Because dragons are like the coolest beasts or like creatures that your brain could possibly imagine, right?
Yeah. To give all credits to that, yes, because who doesn't want to show all of their love and support for our one true God, Nicobolus.
Absolutely. Look at that handsome man.
Yeah, I mean, he is very handsome.
He's very...
Really? He's got the frickin'...
I mean, they daddied him.
Put these on him. He's the intelligent gremlin from Gremlins 2, okay?
Tell
me he's sexy.
Right. Hour of Devastation and War of the Spark, they daddied him up. They made him a little sexier. True. Old Nicobolus, for a long time. Nicobolus is
Gremlins 2, folks.
Ugly.
Gremlins 2, all right?
Yeah, he had a
like that's up. They printed him up in the New Age. Listen, he went into he got 1,000 years of beauty sleep. It really did him a service.
Maybe he just used some of his Grixis power to glow up.
He ain't no Divizet reborn. He ain't no Shadrix. Or who's honestly personally my favorite is Galzith Prismari is my favorite thirsty boy.
Yeah. No, man, dude, Niv-Mizzet.
Dude, what a playful
reborn. He's like, I am
ridiculous.
Sex.
Like Niv-Mizzet is like, I can't remember which card it is. I'm sure I'll put it on screen. I'll remember it later.
The five color?
No, there's basically like cards where like he just can't stop looking at himself in the mirror.
Yeah.
He's so obsessed with how pretty he is and how like and the one thing. Shout out to the animators on Magic Arena when that set came out. Which set am I thinking of? Niv-Mizzet, the new one. The blue 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 red red red.
Oh, War of the Spark?
Is that the one that card is
Reborn,
from?
Right?
Reborn is the five color.
Reborn is the five color that came out
it's
of War of the Spark.
It's Niv-Mizzet Perun.
Yeah, there's
Gilds of Ravnica.
Gilds of Ravnica.
So that card, when they released it on Arena, it came with an animation.
Yeah.
When you cast it, he would like float into the battlefield and sit down and like curl his paws together.
Yep.
It was like magnificent.
Happy
and I was
Pride
like,
Month.
Yeah. So very cat-like.
He is. He's basically like a cat dragon. And
very much so.
I
he's
love
got like
it.
The you know the fluffy kind of
Niv-Mizzet is the image. Shit. Shout
he's
out
a, he's,
to
a, he's a very
so
good
is
boy.
So is that like to you? Is he like the hottest dragon
Ooh.
In Magic the Gathering?
Yeah. Who do you think is the hottest dragon?
Emery coming in with the good questions.
Wait, I can't
the
be on questions. Here and not talk yeah. about
the hottest
sexy
dragons?
Dragons.
Okay, hold
I'm
on. Wait,
bring this
wait,
out
wait.
Because
let's,
this is, I was going to gear for this.
Let's talk about top five.
Top
let's
five.
Talk about top five.
Top five dragons.
I. We need to see some pictures. Just like rate those dragons, Brady.
We
gotta talk about the dragons of Tarkir.
Nice little segment. MTG dragon.
None of them
smash
are sexy.
Pass. Letzi go, everybody.
Ojutai's the only one who's worth.
Ojutai's
the most
sleek.
Beautiful.
Very sleek.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, very
right?
pretty.
Dramaka's she'd be like a sexy bigger bay. You
I
know?
Like Dramaka's like the jaw of Dramaka.
Well, she's like, you know, she's like, she got what?
Give me that for a second. I'm gonna show you guys the most.
Trying to think of the right person.
We got stuff like the Ur Dragon. We got Chromium.
But the thing is
Chromium's pretty sick, dude.
Chromium is pretty cool.
Chromium looks like
very sleek.
They need tissue paper everywhere before sex. You know, it's like I'm just gonna lay this out on the bed just like so, and we're gonna go with another one just like this, we're gonna follow this up with a nice little buddy tissue right over here.
Yeah,
and we're just gonna we're just gonna cover the whole
Don't touch
bed
that.
In these.
Yeah.
What's your my name? Chromium.
Chromium.
A Southern Belle.
If you're familiar with the band Chromio, I could see Chromium. Being
just like some nice little synth pop in the background.
Third member of that band.
All right, I'm gonna show you
some
guys.
Dude in a tuxedo and a freaking keyboard in the background, wearing glasses like these.
What are you doing, Brando? What are you got some
He's
dragon contention?
My vote is Shadrix.
Shadrix
and Galzeth Prismari.
Because it's a card that I still need for my Miriam deck, and it's one of the just like the weirdest cards.
Describe it to me. I'm gonna see if I can guess it.
It's a dragon
mm-hmm.
in a red dress. Or pink dress, sorry.
Whoa.
What?
It's for some reason, it's so, like, not in a bad way, it's so gender-coded, and it makes no sense to me, but it's such a fun card and, like, card
art. A dragon in a pink dress? I don't know what this is. What is it?
Big reveal.
Okay.
Big reveal.
Oh, sorry, Cloud.
See?
You're so much abuse today,
take
Cloud.
Him away.
We'll give you that. We'll splash it on
no
the screen.
No one likes Cloud anyways.
A bad day.
Patron of the Arts.
Oh my god.
Dragon Noble. When Patron of the Arts enters the battlefield or dies, create a treasure token. That's actually
it
not.
It makes sense. It was from Baldur's Gate. It makes sense.
Yeah. But, like, it's the weirdest thing because every other dragon, or even, like, Dragonborn or this or that, like, half of them are either half naked or going this, going that. They all seem dragony. They all
That's
seem
right.
like, oh, maybe humanoid, but they all seem dragony.
The
this
dragon
is the borns. Most, this is well, the most out of place I've seen dragon art be where just.
Yeah, totally. Honestly, they maybe should have done Dragonborn as a creature type instead of dragons, because that's not a dragon, that's a Dragonborn.
Yeah, actually, that's true, right?
What were your top five?
Okay, sorry.
Fifth edition.
If we'll go back to my top fives, it's limited by my knowledge of dragons. I don't know every dragon in Magic, and I'm not...
Top five sexy dragons
that come to your mind. I'm talking Bolas, Ojutai, Chromium, Niv-Mizzet, and my... This isn't in general order.
But top five.
But...
Galazeth
is pretty dope.
Yeah, he's pretty cool.
Galazeth
is
Ur-Dragon my bae.
At one point too.
Yeah, but Ur-Dragon's just.
I was gonna say, does Ur-Dragon get it because he's the daddy of the
daddy?
Dragons? Like he's
he's
the
rough
best dragon
edges.
Commander.
He's like that uncle you got
Except
that's got
Tiamat.
Like rough hands, you know.
See, for me, my top five are it's a tie between Galazeth and Shadrix, but it's weird because both alt arts for both of them are kind of. Well, the original art for Shadrix for me is boring. Even though it's gorgeous, it's still boring. Whereas the alt for Shadrix is like stupendous, absolutely amazing. I want a wall of it. Beautiful. And got sex appeal. Whereas Galazeth immediately starts off like the only card I've seen in the entire game that literally looks like Bahamut from Final Fantasy. Like, actually, I challenge you in this checkout, and he's doing his Omega Breath, like, or a Mega Flare. You know,
I'm just going to remind myself in the editing process that Top 5 Dragon Sex Appeal is the title of this
That
episode.
Was the title.
Absolutely.
And then third would be...
Absolutely. I wouldn't have it any other
And time. Then I struggle from third. I guess Ojutai is beautiful, but beautiful. I'm not sure if Ojutai would be a fickle lover. Like, you know... I'm not in the mood.
Yeah.
Can you get that away from like you're in the morning, you're like rustling around, you got your like you know your morning wood. And Ojutai's like, nay, like no, bitch, you sexy. Come on, get closer. Like Ojutai's like,
he's
not today.
A tea drinker, and you'd rather have like a beer drinker.
Yeah, like
he wants
what?
His biscuit
like,
first.
A little rough around the edges.
Yeah, like a every blue moon under a blue moon kind of lay. Nah, that's not for me. So probably Niv-Mizzet third. Reborn, 100%.
No, you don't have to name the card. It's just the dragon, right?
Well, no, there's of it. There's
talking about art.
There's periods. There's periods of it.
He gets
so reborn, reborn. He's flush. He's engorged, right? He's like, I am the guild pack. I'm the boner. I am the guild pack.
Yeah, engorged isn't a word that I would have used, but
engorged. He's engorged. He's looking good.
He does get the big dick energy points for being the living guild.
Fourth
pack.
Would be
absolutely
the other reborn, where it's the. Aftermath, whatever you call it. Not Aftermath. March of the Machine version. Love that card, too. The spectacular design.
Oh,
love the design.
It was in the Aftermath boosters,
yeah,
was it
it's
not?
Amazing design on that. And then, Weirdly enough, the fifth one is that weird judge promo. I can't remember his name right off the top of my head.
I can't remember.
So I'll look it up. He's got eyeballs.
I can't remember.
How weird.
Well, let's
we had a whole podcast about it.
I don't know why any of you were saying Chromium, even remotely, because I'm going to sit here right now and splash this on the screen.
Well, wait, you got a different art here.
Yeah, it's okay, because this is old original Chromium.
Yeah, he's got Mechagodzilla. He's got Mechagodzilla Chromium.
No, this is the old original Chromium.
Yeah.
Mechagodzilla. He's just a transformer.
Mechagodzilla.
He's just a transformer. Yeah, and then that, all that is.
No, see?
Yeah. See, that's not even, like, we're talking sex appeal, right? That's not sexy. That's a hood ornament.
That's the kind of shit you steal off the front of a Jaguar.
But some of us swag. Can appreciate art, okay?
That's pretty funny.
Yeah,
that's pretty
it's
funny.
Very beautiful.
Art and sex appeal are very different.
Yeah,
things.
See, the mutable
not always.
Definitely lays down tissue paper before he comes.
Dude, I'm talking, like,
he's come on.
Tell me, like, when the DeLorean came out that people weren't horny about the DeLorean.
I don't want to fuck a car.
And I've come.
Well, then this is different. This is where we're different.
Listen.
Okay.
I'm not shaming the people who have big crushes on RC from Transformers either. You do you, boo-boos. I'm sorry. I don't. That's not sex appeal.
He's a tissue layer.
Okay. All right. That's, top five dragons
Chromium
you want to fuck.
Chromium is a
freaking
starfish in bed. Argue me this.
Nicobolas. Nicobolas Dragon God. Nicobolas the Ravager. Nicobolas Planeswalker.
Gremlins 2.
And then,
I want you to watch that and come back to me.
Nicobolas?
Would you fap your meat to Gremlins 2?
A little cute one.
Jesus Christ.
I went too far.
Jesus Christ.
I'm not a pedophile.
Oh, he's of age.
Look at Galazeth.
When you
flex in that.
He's legit.
Oh, actually, no. I think there is literally eggshells around him.
Yeah, they were just born in that chibi.
This episode, by the way, is dedicated to all the fairies out there and only you.
Well, no, it's gay. It's gay pride. Well, LGBTQ.
Yeah, it is pride weekend.
Oh, by the way, y'all, I am starting a fundraiser for that right now. There's a not-for-profit for Calgary here. Yeah, it's the outreach for LGBTQ. I just messed up my eligibility. I just messed up my eligibility there. But no, honestly, I am doing a fundraiser now right now for it. We only have a little bit of money in there, but yeah, just let you know.
Do you have somewhere that you can point people towards?
It is my Facebook. It is a Facebook-sponsored thing.
Not a confident fundraiser.
No, it's not a very confident fundraiser,
just
unfortunately.
Just send money to my email.
But no, it's just a thing that anyone can honestly do. It's one feature I think really is amazing about Facebook, even though I can't trust a lot about Facebook. I think that this is at least going for, and it's non-for-profit organizations, which is incredible. They do way more work than every other one that doesn't have actual sponsoring. So,
yeah.
You know, it makes a huge difference. And honestly, Calgary, as much as we're an amazing city, it's a bit of a far cry when it comes to the progressive things in place for at least other cities when it comes to the eligibility crowd, which is my favorite. I just saw that as a meme today. The eligibility. I need to talk to my eligibility crowd out there. It's really, really funny. But no, either way, though, it's a good little cause here. I'm really stoked about. Oh, hell yeah. You just pulled that one out?
What is it?
I totally missed that. They printed a new five-color nib.
Yeah, no, this is not
the
sex appeal?
This is out of the aftermath one.
M-A-T is aftermath.
Oh, yeah, okay. I was thinking aftermath. For some reason, aftermath and War of the Spark was crossing in my mind.
No, War of the Spark was years old now.
It was after, yeah. I didn't know that they did that. That's cool.
Speaks to how little that brought.
I got a bit of a vote for Nimot to the Devastator. I feel like his head can just go weird places.
Can we see?
You know? Yeah.
He's
Numot the Devastator.
Numot.
That's some next level cunnilingus there.
You know what? I mean, like, to take back my thing, I'm just going to say.
Wait. No takes backsies.
Nicobolas the Ravager can be number five. The first three spots are Miriam, because she deserves all the love in the world.
First three?
She's insane, though.
Yeah.
One and two more for her
I think Dragon
tokens
God
that she makes, right?
Is peak. Peak Nicobolas art.
See, that's
he's brooding. He's very like.
Yeah, but he also has five condoms on his dick, and I don't.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
He does not sleeve that thing. Do not even try to say he does.
What are you talking about? He is nothing but sleeved. He's got so many contingencies, bro. He's got backup plan upon backup plan, and they all require his dick covered.
I was
going to
say
some kind
of
condom.
Can I say cock? Because like he's definitely gilded head to toe.
Gilded
head to toe. Like he's got arm guards. He's got guards for each single ab that he has. Yeah, he's got a cock guard.
Not only is he ribbed for whoever's pleasure they deem
you
necessary.
You are too experienced, Texter! Right? You know what?
He yeah. also
you know
has what? The archetypical egg between mm-hmm. the horny.
Mm-hmm. Oh, he's thirsty.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Fix it on, it vibrates.
Horny egg.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gilded ribbed. The dude is sex appeal.
Here's, you know one, here's one for the list. Card nobody knows. Out of the unstats. Stet, draconic proofreader. He's a dragon bureaucrat.
He's got glasses.
You know, hey. Yeah, but, we all have glasses here, sir.
But look at, that's true.
But look at him. He's so formal, and he's jacked.
And he's killing a whole bunch of
he's
mice.
He's basically just, he's just Superman when he's playing Clark Kent.
Yo, actually, can we shout out the artist of this? This is hilarious.
It is Dimitri Bermak?
Yeah. Bermak?
Yeah, Dimitri Bermak.
I find it so cool to hear about, like, the artists of Magic, because I don't know if you guys know, I will shout this out every time I can. Mm-hmm. Magic the Gathering, Wizards of the Coast, D&D, like, Wizards of the Coast is the premier mm-hmm. commissioner of fantasy art worldwide, not even fucking close. Mm-hmm. The amount of artists in the world that are paid and paid and paid regularly to create incredible fantasy art for ridiculous purposes. Mm-hmm. Wizards of the Coast pays those people and commissions more art than anybody in the world tenfold. And that artist that created that, what I would love to see mm-hmm. is the notes that were given. I love seeing the artist notes
yeah.
being like, because they design the card, they design the blah, blah, blah. And then when they push it to the artist, they're like, we want these three or four things. The funniest things in Magic is the artists who got those notes and misinterpreted them mm-hmm. and then created a piece of art that technically followed those notes, but like with the wrong interpretation. And the wizard gets it and they're like, oh.
Well, we cannot now.
This yeah. is strange because like you thought I meant this, but
change
I meant
it
this.
To a different
and
card.
Sometimes those yeah. arts just make it to the final print and they're awesome stories.
Honestly, speaking of the arts specifically, I do love how the community kind of shapes mm-hmm. the success. A lot of ways it does make sense because we're talking about a game where it's saturated with intense, brilliant artwork. But when our first podcast, I was talking about Rebecca Gay or even yep. like Teresa Nilsson, Carl Critchlow, some of my favorite absolute artists back in the day. But when you look at their art as it was then, especially for what was expected of the game, to a lot of where the game's artwork has now adapted, it's insane. And then you have these new ones like Seb McKinnon is one of my favorites.
Oh, Seb McKinnon is an incredible
Dominic Meyer
artist.
Dominic Meyer made an absolute just destroyed my brain for Nuka Penna, a lot of the art from Nuka Penna. Esper Ising. Yes. Literally, I'm also one of the. I would love to get Esper Ising on our channel when we're ready for him. Oh, frick,
you
that'd be so
gotta
amazing.
Gotta be able to pay for it.
Maybe we can probably get his attention with some like bird photos. You can come here and take photos of our birds too. You know,
we have magpies.
Yeah, either way, though, it's brilliant right to here. See how the art has affected even for popularity of some spells. You know, or because you know, I think if our Yargle, called back to my boy here, Yargle, hadn't been so amazingly simple, but also just dramatic in its art. And even the writing was pretty great because he almost fucked up the leather light, you know? Like, you know, I just like the community then at that point directed the, you know, and helped influence and where it kept going because it wasn't just the artist now creating Yargle artwork. But yeah, it's for anybody taking on then the prestige of who it's like, somebody who designs Spider-Man, you know, like I didn't realize for a number of years that one of my favorite heroes of all time growing up, Seth MacFarlane, creator of Spawn, he literally helped direct Spider-Man and influence Spider-Man's story in dramatic, intense ways, creating the symbiotes and shit like that. So when you have an artist.
Seth MacFarlane was somewhat responsible for
Seth
MacFarlane Venom and Carnage?
Created Spawn.
What?
Or oh, not no, Spawn, I, yeah. Venom. Venom. He created
Seth
Venom.
Seth MacFarlane had his hands in creating Venom?
Todd McFarlane?
Yeah, you're thinking wrong.
So sorry.
Sorry,
yeah.
So Todd.
It would be a McFarlane.
Mixing up the McFarlanes here. But that's no, okay. Todd McFarlane.
Yeah. I follow what you were talking about.
Todd McFarlane, he created Venom.
That's fucking
it was an
cool.
artwork. You look at the face of Venom, his own creation of Spawn. Effective.
Yes.
So now back to how this might correlate to Magic and one of
the
things
that is the coolest collab ever. I had no idea that
the way that the artists then take on the role of okay, I'm now illustrating Liliana Vess. Okay, here are the details that are most important mm-hmm. to me. But then they add their own take to it. And then that of over time does mm-hmm. evolve the attachment of the person to that character in a lot of ways. And then, I don't know, I love that. There's so much weird psychology to it. You know, how people with this game then attach themselves, the importance of the cards, the artwork, everything, how they interact with people. I know a lot of people who defend Magic the Gathering for their social skills, you know? It's just love that about the artwork. The artwork, it starts with the artwork, I think, first and foremost for a lot of people, because otherwise you're just left with a really technical, complicated game.
All right, I'm going to cycle this back to Eldraine.
Yeah.
Sexiness. Artwork.
Yeah.
Where the fuck is Oko?
Yeah, where the fuck is Oko?
Oko's about to be showing off his ass with some freaking little
Outlaws of Thunder Junction.
Yeah, he's still a planeswalker?
That was my question, because a lot of planeswalkers got desparked, but I think we're the ones that participated in the
fight. I think it was
fight.
Participation. It was participation.
So, no.
Was Oko selfish and just like on his own journey? Or like, how is
I wish
Oko
I
still
was it like an ending effect? Because I still have decided to
this
be stubborn about the
no,
story.
No, this is a little bit of the point of contention when it comes to just the general lore of what was going on
the
with all of that.
The story was so dense. The story
was so dense, but unfortunately, because of some of the higher ups making certain calls off of how things are being moved forward, they haven't given the time, the space, or the availability for the writers of Magic to do the same work that they did.
They did that with the War of the Spark, though.
At least half of the planeswalkers that have been desparked have literally been desparked, not because there was a reason for it, not because they even participated, just because they said, nope, they're a legendary creature now. We don't want them as a planeswalker anymore.
Though, no, they better not have fucked with Ashiok.
Ashiok is still a planeswalker in the set because
they're only going to do one planeswalker.
I have a theory that he's going to be a big bad still. So because Ashiok's been behind the scenes for a minute. He's been doing more than the fucking Raven Man. Yeah. They finally printed the Raven Man as a card, in this case Limduel.
Yeah,
so it's cool.
I think someone had said to me that Ashiok is teaming up with Will Kenrith, or
no,
Kenrith is
the
helping
the
Fae folks.
Rowan.
What?
Rowan.
Well, because. I think Kenrith is the Scion of Peace, right? And he wants to make friends
Kenrith
with the Fae folk.
Yeah.
Kenrith is dead.
Will Kenrith.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, the son. Yeah,
Will Kenrith,
the father,
his son.
The mother and father, the king and queen died. So Will is the brother. Will is fighting for the good of...
Yeah.
In the story of the Wilds of Eldraine, Will is...
The flavor text is great on his card. It's essentially just being like, why would we fight these people when, you know, they'll just be bodies afterwards. Yeah. Like, we could turn them and make them our friends instead of just killing them needlessly. And I was like, you go, girl. You go, Will. I'm on his side. It's crazy.
Yeah, Rowan has been persuaded by one of the witches that the slumber that was enacted to
Arionette or whatever.
One of the witches.
They wanted the twins to... Oh, that's good writing.
They're pitting the twins against each other, which is kind of cool.
It's cool.
But Rowan has been persuaded, very unjustly, that the slumber that was enacted to keep the Phyrexians at bay was actually better for the people of Eldraine, and that the slumber was very peaceful and like their dreams that they were having were very nice. Mm-hmm. They're actually having fucking crazy nightmares the whole time.
Oh, yeah.
And Will knows that. And then so that's why the two of them are fighting. And Ashiok, I believe in the story of Wilds of Eldraine, Ashiok, there's sort of a point where Ashiok's control over the situation, which Ashiok might be sort of responsible for the nightmares.
The card name is Manipulator.
Right. And I think Ashiok gets basically just this war is lost and bounces.
Yeah.
Well, interesting enough, one of the sets says he put a dream directly into Elesh Norn's head of her unsuccessfully fucking with
Elspeth.
Elspeth.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So as soon as I read that, I was just like, oh my God, this is because we had a lot of theories bouncing around what was going to happen. I was largely true about at least a Thanos effect of, okay, where can the writing go, the simplicity, the directions? Because after War of the Spark, Wizards has made critical mistakes on the pacing and, you know, that's already the EA effect. I call it the EA effect, where it's all about money. It's not about the end product. You just release it. Fuck it. Fuck what people think. Yeah. So in this case, I think it's really appropriate. Ashiok should be the newest enemy. He's been tiptoeing around for a while. Well, no, he's...
Ashiok also, I will say, is androgynous. Very, very not he or she.
Or he or she. Well, I mean, yes.
They are the absolute first non-binary planeswalker.
Yeah. Okay. No, it's easy to forget with Magic the Gathering. I think they will. I think they will be, 100%. Why not? They've already been, they revel
you're
in...
You're saying that Ashiok will be the new heel, the new bolus, the...
Something of it. There's always one. There's
very cool. But
even in
also,
the writing, Karavik got released from his weird time bubble, so we have a whole bunch of villains that are going to be popping out of nowhere.
Because
I think Ashiok is going to be one of the big ones.
Because... We have out-of-story written lore that Tezzeret's still behind the scenes pulling a bunch of shenanigans.
But that's fine. That's to be expected. That could just say.
And very likely going to resurface again very soon. And that we have unnamed, unidentified watchers
that have been acknowledged purely by they've been watching.
Yeah, mystery. Yeah.
Those are likely going to be the big bads.
Well, yeah, but I mean, it's the same way that the way when Bolas was first integrated into the story, he was supposed to be the first.
Mm-hmm.
He was the first big bad. But then, the next 20 or so years, we've only had the Phyrexians as the absolute Borg of the series. And then Bolas had his moment.
Another Star Trek reference.
Yeah, no. And then we went back. And then we went back to the Phyrexians, and they've had now. They've after all these years, you know, Wizards have finally decided to put them aside.
So now we have, and now the multiverse is all connected. We have endless array of villainry. Ashiok has way more place, way more integral, slowly creeping the same way they decided to do so for Bolas.
Oh, yeah.
At some point, Ashiok's going to have an outrageous moment, and then we'll likely have a Voldemort moment and get put down like all villains do.
I'm not denying that he's going to potentially be a... that they are going to thematically be a big bad for a point. I almost guarantee you they are not the big bad.
Well, at least a big story turning point.
I think if anything, Ashiok becomes kind of like the placeholder for like what Tezzeret was over the, like the last.
That would be cool.
Tezzeret's gonna be. I think Tezzeret's gonna be a big one. Very, very much so.
I think 100%. Something super cool as well with Nicol Bolas and Phyrexians.
Mm.
So before Yawgmoth even got to what was then called Phyrexia, after he kind of transformed the plane, it was just like a place of just artifacts, like kind of like Mirrodin before the oil. And there was supposedly a god that was on there before anybody else who created this plane, who was a dragon who took the form of a humanoid occasionally.
Oh, this is in the book, actually.
And this is like thousands and thousands and thousands of years before Yawgmoth.
In the book, they do come across that. Yeah, I remember.
How many like dragons that are like humanoidish, you know? But he's never really like gone out and been like, oh, I'm like a human dragon character. I would assume Nicol Bolas.
Oh, so there's a tale of a dragon.
It's a theory that's jumping around online. Named in the story as like the dragon.
One thing that Wizards could literally dive way more into is the incredible amount of time in which Azor and Ugin and Bolas all were interacting with each other, because Bolas for a while there was the big bad, and Ugin, they're very long back in the day, Ugin and Azor, somewhere, I can't remember exactly how long, but it's thousands of years. Both are literally god mode planeswalkers at this point, and Azor at this point has been going around to plane doing things like he did to Ravnica, infecting with Hieromancy, just like enacting and instilling law and order as what he thought it was. And while he was doing all that kind of stuff, Ugin was getting really freaked out because he had an idea of what Bolas was doing, so then he started working with Azor. So in between this entire this ginormous stretch of time, there's a lot that Wizards could start producing for us. Yeah. Literally, there's a lot of backstory that could be supplemented. Yeah.
There's also a lot of times where they set something up and then completely forget
about
it. So you never know. Like, as much as I'd love to be like, oh, I can't wait to see Nicol Bolas come back. Can't wait to see. They had options to bring him back to help against
like
the Phyrexians. I thought that would have been cool.
It's the comic book.
You know, so many balls dropped. Lazatep plating would be the only thing that the Phyrexians would not be able to conquer.
Can I just point out,
I thought that that was going to be the big thing. Like, they have to get Nicol Bolas to come back to help and get, like, the big
Wizards
bad
of
to
the
be the
coast.
One. You know, different things like that. So there's tons of options.
I will say, sorry, there is one of Nicol Bolas' brothers does have
which
a card.
Which is realistically all dragons,
no,
right?
Well, okay.
All dragons came from the Tempest.
They went
back after, what was
from
that?
The Ur Dragon is the first dragon.
They went back and like rewrote it so that everything comes from that dragon tempest. So realistically, all dragons are their nephews or nieces or brothers or something like that. Ugin was only introduced in...
I'm specifically talking about a litter. We'll call it a litter of dragons. There was a batch of eggs. And of those eggs, Ugin and Bolas were a twin from the same egg. They were born of the same egg, I believe. But one of their brothers, the card literally talks about that dragon taking the form of a human. And I believe that's chromium.
That would make sense because too, if it was
chromium,
a plane of artifacts.
Yeah, chromium has the ability. I think it's you pay one mana, or you know, I think it's discard a card, and he becomes a 1/1 human. And I believe in the story, chromium does parade around as a human.
Good old titular, hey?
And he's cool. Yeah, he's Bolas's brother. I'll bring up the card just to confirm the wording on that, but I'm pretty certain that might be...
So while he does that, first of all, there's two levels to them not bringing Bolas back, and that is...
What the fuck? Sliv Mizzet Hive Mind?
Yeah, I love it.
I'm sorry.
Have you seen Sliv Drazi Monstrosity?
Yeah, he's got it.
Yeah, I've got it.
nasty.
Yeah, we're building a deck around it right now.
Oh.
So they were never going to bring Bolas back. They might have teased it a little bit here and there. Just
also
for the sake
of 8 years.
Oh, no, and exactly that. They weren't going to bring it back because they just got over him being a part of the story.
Yeah.
Same with the Eldrazi sort of thing. They ended his story. They're going
to
leave him alone for a while.
Yeah.
Like, they weren't going to do that. Second to that is because if they were to bring Bolas back, it really they would have had to shoot themselves in the foot on the story because Lazarus plating, sure. However, it either leads into Bolas trying to Phyrexianize himself so that he can be even more perfect, which doesn't make sense because he thinks he's too perfect, or him becoming Phyrexianized anyways and becoming much more of a dominant force than even Elish Norn, because let's be real here. A Phyrexianized Bolas would not have been stopped.
My money, my hope.
Well, they could do the same thing with that lovely little Emrakul in the moon, right?
I want a
again, which is where I thought it was going.
But she's not a villain.
I think, you know what I'd make myself? You know what I'm making the sexiest character
right?
in the entire game?
It's all perception.
A Prince Zuko redemption arc.
Who's Prince Zuko?
Avatar: Last Airbender. Okay. I want me the most beautiful story in which he's
just
a wholesome little newt now.
No.
Where he's like, you know what, I have all this knowledge, and he's been so
he's,
put in his place
in
that he
out, yeah.
that the ultimate arrogance, I think even beyond the Phyrexians, I believe this, because they had a lot going on there, but they had like some weird science things supporting their fanaticism.
Mm-hmm.
He literally thought he was everything. I believe that to make him the most humble motherfucker would be the greatest thing they could do for his returning to the story.
And that's where I was like, this would be a great way for the story to come back around. It makes like, you know, like a good guy out of like this big villain that we've had for forever. Like, mm-hmm. yeah, that does kind of feel cheap.
From the beginning.
And stuff. However, he could potentially get his godhood in the eyes of the people that worship him, like the proper way, rather than
that
trying
to cool.
force godhood. He's
returns
seen
to
Amonkhet. Finally as
returns
a god.
To Amonkhet. Yeah,
yeah.
And he's actually an actual good god.
Magic, wizards, I swear to God, if you steal this from me and don't give me credit. No, it's already done. It's
I don't know
late.
If I want to see Nicol Bolas come in and drink tea with people and be
perfect
friendly.
Perfect character arc. It's about the story.
You know what?
Yeah.
No, it's about the story, not about
how cool the villain is.
No.
Leave us in the comments what you think. Should Nicol Bolas come back as a humble piece of shit or as a horrible piece of shit?
To fight against the greater good?
There's only one caveat I will give you guys, and that is that if they do this, then Jace has to be the replacement new big bad. And I say this because...
I think so too.
If you're going to take the Mickey Mouse Jace of Magic the Gathering... Jace is to Mickey Mouse as Nicol Bolas is to Steamboat Willie. If you're gonna take the OG villain and make him good guy, you better take the OG good guy and make him the villain.
Absolutely.
Oh,
I
how
agree.
The tables have turned.
Exactly.
You know the one thing when he was slowly turning, he's just like, I don't need to, like, after all the story, after all the writing and all the fans shitting on Jace over the years, the one time he's just like, you do not want me. You do not want me to be completed. You need to deal with it. We need to deal with this
kill
now.
Me before, otherwise
I will make your heads explode. He was literally meaning it. Like, this is the kind of guy who literally took all the power he had from the Guild Pact, the very magic that Azor created, and humbled Azor himself and smited him to a shit-covered rock.
Absolutely.
You know?
Out of all of the planeswalkers who were completed, he was the one that scared me the most. Cameo come out and we're like, holy shit.
Yeah.
Like, she's so powerful. Like, she's got great stuff going on.
You know what? Liliana. Lisa. I still think it was Liliana is chiefly because she was actually immortal around the time that she had her spark. So, and Bolas, it's in the story where Liliana comes across Bolas after, I think it's the Maelstrom. And he's all smout and being like, you're a planeswalker, and gives her this like, you have no idea the taste of power that we had. And apparently she already kind of did. She was already doing a lot of crazy shit. But at this point, she was just like this humble necromancer at this point, and actually heals Bolas back, brings him back after the maelstrom on Alara. So the thing is really cool. This is a way back. So as soon as in the story, again, the genius himself literally orchestrated Liliana's help before he even realized that he needed her, or probably already did. It's like, oh, you're a badass necromancer? Done. That's the thing. I think you can't get rid of somebody like that. When you have him from, like, what, 94, his first card was printed, something like that, about a year after this game.
Was it Legends or something?
One of the very first, like, very, very first Legends ever printed. Let's get a check.
I brought up Chromium, and you just...
We have one of the very first, you know? It's just...
Sorry.
I don't know. I think it's hard to ignore that. Why keep going back to the Phyrexians, if we can't go back to the Bolas in a similar way, you know, we finally got Limduel again. Y'all, one of the first Necromancer big bad in the series ever. Ever. And he is the Raven Man. So we finally have new directions for the story to develop, and these big characters, I think they're going to have some more say. Ashiok, I think, will be a character arcing. Yeah. It kind of makes sense that they won't be the actual big bad.
Yeah.
More like, I'm still just going to keep fucking around, similar to Tybalt, but with way more weight. Mm-hmm. Actually, what happened to Tybalt?
Tybalt is...
He got stabbed by his own table. Oh, Tyvar. Tail and thrown That's off true. At the edge of a cliff.
So did Tyvar murder him then? Because he was fighting Tyvar when that happened.
Depicted on the card Tyvar's Last Stand.
Absolutely.
I believe so.
Tyvar's badass. Oh, man.
Let me see Tyvar. He is very cool. His new card is very cool.
The Bellicose?
No
I made
longer
a
Planeswalker.
I made the Tyvar the Bellicose deck. It is absolutely insane to be able to do Raga Draga style things in Golgari. Yeah. Oh, so cool.
All right.
So, yeah, to throw back about the Chromium thing with the human thing, his ability is discard a card until end of turn. Chromium the Mutable becomes a human and with base power and toughness 1/1, loses all abilities and gains hexproof. Can't be blocked this turn. Absolute rogue. Mm-hmm. Completely slipped through the fucking cracks.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty. I gotta say, if we're talking about
like
a dragon of that era that created a plane, artifacts.
Maybe not even had enough magical power to influence it or something.
Yeah.
No. But no, it even suggests they were there.
Chromium is.
Wizards!
Yeah. Wizards.
Is this a planeswalker we don't know about?
Well, I think they're. I don't think we're really going back to the realm of planeswalkers and stuff.
I mean, I want some throwback. I want some sets that Sarah Angel with her lover, or Sarah with Sarah? Her lover. Yeah. I want that story.
Well, we did actually in Modern Horizons
Arabian
too,
Nights.
Right?
Let's go back. Arabian Nights. Let's go back to the apparently triumphantly most powerful planeswalker that actually did ever exist outside of
Sarah.
Oh, sorry.
You talking about Sarah?
No, I'm talking about, in Arabian Nights, there is a planeswalker that exists that was formed after, I think it was like 5 of the mana or whatever, all came to converge and created this ultimate being.
Mm-hmm.
There's not, and we're talking about one of the most obscure sites that Mike Rosewater, actually you might know more about this because of me, but Mike Rosewater covered this a while ago as to why they didn't go back to Arabian Nights. I think there's like a lot of like complex.
Oh,
it's too rooted in real life, right? That's why when they went back to Kanagawa,
was it really?
They changed it completely and they did like modern age or
so that makes sense, but either way, you know, we don't have this though, and we have now the time, the writing, the right PC look, I guess, at maybe reevaluating how the story was too close to the, you know, to the truth or whatever.
You start to tread on water where it's like, are things starting to get like,
yeah, I know, that makes sense.
Yeah,
like evoke prejudice.
A lot of
we don't want to do that. We don't want
to
do that.
Oh, there's kind of a double-edged.
There's so much to cover.
There's kind of there's kind of a double-edged sword as well as like a large amount of hypocrisy when it comes to that. That still goes on. This might be a little heavy, so sorry, guys. Nothing bad.
Here we go.
So we can go to Kamigawa, and they can change that around whatever. We can go to the old Kamigawa. We can go to Kamigawa, Neon Dynasties sort of thing. It's not a problem that exists with doing things that are based around other cultures. It's that much of the West, and I'm not saying Wizards, I'm not saying Hasbro. I don't think that they are as companies, but it's one of those things where unfortunately people, and then thus the people who want to get angry about these sort of topics, which again, people are justified in wanting to make sure that things are more politically correct, and people are justified in allowing a stance to make sure that people aren't being hurt anymore. It's kind of like the whole shift from tribal cards to typal cards. It's just making sure that we don't step on toes and like that people are okay with things.
But also typal makes more sense.
Yeah.
Yep.
It just makes more sense. Well, I mean, like, I always used to say like treasure tribal when I had Corvold, right? But treasure typal makes sense.
Yeah.
It's not a...
The deeper you go down the rabbit hole, the more it makes sense, or more tribal doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Past that, it's that currently the modern world still has an incredible subconscious hate for what is the Middle East. It's not that we couldn't go back to Arabian Nights or something similar to that. It's that no company, especially Magic the Gathering, is going to touch it, because the second that they do, they could legitimately, and they have been over like the last 10 years specifically, Magic, sitting down with like cultural advisors to make sure that everything coming out or any of the things that they do concerning properties that might reflect real world stuff doesn't cross that line. But we still, like, we'll get single characters that'll kind of fit that niche of like, oh, maybe they're like subset. They've got the Muslimic, or they're making
fantasy characters.
Yeah.
Out of real life things,
exactly.
And that's where things get weird.
Yeah.
Because why are you fantasizing about this in like a fantasy-esque way.
Makes you wonder how
gets things weird.
How the new Assassin's Creed Egypt, right?
Well, again, because again, that's one of those weird things where it's like they kind of get around that because unfortunately,
with the popularity of
Egyptian
mythology,
it's incredibly rooted in real life.
It's because it's whitewashed. It's because everything that they can do with those properties is it's not about, oh, we're going back to ancient Egypt, which we already did, Hour of Devastation. It's they're going through, like, especially with Assassin's Creed sort of thing, they've looked at it through the, like, it's a history book. It is the victors wrote the story, so we get to tell those stories.
Do you know the origin of the word history? It is his story.
Yeah. Is that true?
Yeah, the winner was able to write his story in the book. That's history. That's what I don't know if that's like super super true, but I've heard that is an anecdote. It's
at very least a good way to say something.
Because I'd love to see us go back to like some sort of like Arabian Nights anthology set. Let's do it, if you guys are going to take the opportune to touch on other cultures in their weird ways, like we just had Kamigawa Neon Dynasties,
they can do that in a different kind of setting though, where they're like even something like Amon Ket as well, where they're creating like a fantasy world based around that culture. If they were to just be like, oh, this is like a regular place like Arabia, that's like a little bit different. Again, if they were to create their own place that's like it's very much like it's based around this, but it's this own fantasy world with its own kind of things going.
Yeah.
It feels different in a way.
No,
realistically, it's the same.
And I completely agree. And that's the way that they should take it. And I hope that we do get to see it. We have our release date up until 2026 now, and it doesn't look like we're really doing much of that because we're getting the Wild West. We're getting horror stories at the white person's manor.
The white person's manor.
I'm sorry. It's Euro Gothic vampire.
That's the Innistrad set, right?
Yeah, it's Euro.
No, Innistrad Remastered is going to be an arena release. Duskmorn is going to be the set that is. It takes place. The entire haunted plane house. Is a haunted house, and it's like an 80s, 90s.
Spooky.
I can't remember what they said. It was like modern horror or like. Yeah, modern horror.
It's like filmed by Mike Flanagan. Right?
Yeah. It's like Clue.
Yeah.
Modern horror, like Family Guy.
Yeah, it's like we're making the right strides and in the right steps, but it's just you got to stop tiptoeing and you got to start taking those rationalizations of just like anything you do could be seen as problematic or potentially racist or this or that. Obviously, use your mind. Obviously, be respectful. But stop tiptoeing around the fact everybody should get this representation. Stop treating it like it's like, oh no, that past isn't okay. It's like, you're right, the past wasn't okay. We're better now.
Stop being also, afraid of that. The last thing we want to do is have things like lost to time because we can't talk about them, right? Like, we want to be able to, be sensitive to how you talk about it.
Mm-hmm. But it can always be better.
Yeah. It can always be better, absolutely. Yeah. So Rowan and Will, awesome story, twin planeswalkers shared a spark. Now that,
sorry, what?
They're not, but he's gonna make the joke anyways.
Sorry, I watched Flowers in the Attic last night. And I couldn't help it.
So I won't go into too much detail to respect privacy, sort of thing. My sister and brother-in-law just had their first kid. And they named her Rowan, and that's all I'm going to say on that. And so because of that, I got into, like, I was going to build a deck about that, and then I, around her sort of thing, and then I saw the new Rowan card, and I'm like, oh, perfect. They're going to hate the fact that this this creature's all about hurting yourself and the Scion of War. Oh, yeah. Then I was sitting there and I was thinking, I was like, okay, well, I really want to build a Will deck now, too, because, like, I love that duality. Spells cost X less based off the life that you've lost. Will is spells cost X less based on the life that you've gained. So I was talking to this boy about building a Will deck and trying to showcase that on the channel because me and you, at some point here too, we've talked about it, but we haven't done it yet. You built me Jetmir and I built you Falco.
Yeah, I did.
And they're such phenomenal decks and I love them both. And I really want to do that with you
because
now,
you're my
thing.
Big plush demon boy.
Do a deck build challenge.
And that's exactly it. We're going to be doing a deck building challenge where I think, we joked about, we haven't really discussed the details, but you build me a Rowan deck and I build you a Will deck.
Okay.
And we'll see how that goes.
Yep. Can do.
Hopefully it'll be soon, but it's probably going to be a little dated for the release of Eldraine.
It'll be a couple months before you guys see it.
Shit, then we should then like kind of do like a thing for the three of us so that it's not just
you. Oh, yeah, we could actually do a while there is other characters in Eldraine, we could just pick two other characters as well, important mm-hmm. to the story.
Mm-hmm.
There is, what is that, Kellen, the white, or the red and white one?
The Fey-blooded?
Yeah, a lot of people are talking about this because it's an adventure,
mm-hmm.
legendary creature, and mm-hmm. the adventure, the sorcery or whatever, is tutor for an equipment or aura that's card.
Interesting.
And it's in the command zone.
That's weird.
So people are like, dude, you put a tutor in the command zone? Yeah. And like, it's, we're probably
what colors?
Red and white.
Yeah, it's perfect. That's a little disgusting. Yeah.
It's going to be an interesting card, so maybe we do one of those as well, because he's apparently pretty important to the story.
Well, I mean, if Rankle got reprinted, I want a Rankle deck. You guys can make me a Rankle deck, please.
Well, I'll say this, right? Just for thematics, Rowan and Will, yep, and we'll do that. And then when it comes to the three of us, we'll figure something else out, because ours kind of made sense in its own right as well. This kind of makes sense. We'll figure out something, and who knows? Maybe when it comes to, like... Thunderjaw
Outlaws
Junction?
Of Thunder Junction.
Outlaws Dandy of Thunder Junction. maybe when it comes to like when that set's released, we'll do something of like, oh yeah, group figure out of like multi-commanders.
Honestly, I love the idea of just like the three of us, two of us helping the other, vice versa. So all of us have had a say in the deck that we're making for each other.
Yeah.
I think that's really cute.
Yeah.
We could do that as like a first 500 episode separation, you know. First 500 like follower, me, first 500 sub episode.
It's like me and you build him a deck, me and him build you a deck.
Exactly, that's what I mean. Yeah, so we're literally, deck. There's yeah, okay. All of us have a say in the decks going into each other, basically.
Okay.
Except for the individual, obviously.
I'm intrigued with that.
That's cute.
Oh, yeah. So we didn't get into the other stuff that we kind of wanted to talk about. So
what was that?
We are going to be shifting away from... Of course, we're still going to be releasing a lot of Commander stuff, but we're going to be shifting away from Commander in a lot of our production mm-hmm. moving forward.
To start talking about the Bergs?
Yeah, so to start showcasing a lot more of the other side, which might still include Commander in weird forms, because one of those is specifically Oathbreaker,
mm-hmm.
which we really want to get to showcasing some Oathbreaker and doing a lot more Oathbreaker content, as well as Pauper. And with Pauper, we are going to try and do a lot of the 60 card, but we do know that we're going to be doing some Pauper Commander as well. We're not walking away from Commander content.
No, we'll do it here and there.
Yeah.
Well, we do. I'd like to just be rotating through all of it.
Yeah.
Instead of just focusing on one.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Because at the end of the day, there's so much that this game has to offer, and we don't want to either shoehorn ourselves or follow the fact that, oh my God, it's so oversaturated on YouTube. Like, we started the idea, and there were like three channels that launched when we like started filming.
Yeah. We didn't start the idea.
I mean, like the Rogue's Passage.
Okay, yeah.
Like when the Rogue's Passage became like, oh hey,
two boys did unite.
Yeah. When it was like the Rogue's Passage, we are doing this. It was like, oops, overnight, three YouTube channels popped out of the ether.
Yeah, but three on top of 45 isn't really like.
No.
There's just a lot of math.
More now.
Yeah.
There's more now. I out of my count, there have been, including ourselves, 12 new Magic the Gathering functionally Commander-based YouTube channels that have started since the beginning of 2023. Well,
it's probably more even than that, right?
Probably. But,
like, just even getting your project able to be searched is tough.
Yeah.
As, you know.
I'm just grateful that we pegged on Rogue's Passage.
Yeah. We got really good SEO.
And we worked on our aesthetic, like our design. Absolutely. I'm so stoked for our merch, by the way. Let's get a bit of like that. It's going to literally represent the work we're putting into this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
White and gold.
White and gold.
But yeah, for now, I mean, I think we should pack this in. We're an hour and a half strong.
What's going on in your life? Anything else you want to cover before we shut this down?
You know what I did last night until 3 in the morning?
Is it
definitely
appropriate?
I was preparing myself. I was preparing myself.
How?
For today. No, absolutely. I stayed up until 3 in the morning playing Baldur's Gate 3.
Oh, cool.
Phenomenal game so far. Really enjoying it. I mean, obviously I play Dungeons & Dragons, but go buy it. Go play it.
Yeah. I'm.
Great game.
I'm waiting. I'm so excited too.
I love that Asterion is a very like prominent character, and everyone's just vibing. He's creating some real queer appreciation in the world right now in the RPG communities, and I just love it. And he's just staring in the decadence. Oh.
He's beautiful. Great game.
Cool.
Highly
suggest.
Yeah, you'll get there.
So, wish me luck at the face-to-face tour. If you guys happen to be on site, I believe it is at the Big Four buildings in Calgary. It's going to be proper convention, big tournament. There's going to be, like, magic artists, token makers, vendors. There's going to be all sorts of shit. Shout out to Wizards of the North. They're going to be there doing their EDH gauntlet. So if you want to win an oversized magic card, I believe they're all you have to do is like play the rounds of their commander and get something like 6 or 8 wins, and then you get a badass prize.
So you're just gonna be like, you know, on the side, like anime girls.
Oh no, we're go,
senpai!
Dude, we're gonna compete in that. Of course we're gonna.
Yeah, I'm not going to compete.
Fuck no.
You and I can be the senpai.
I'm not gonna compete in a face to face. I don't got that level.
No, face-to-face. It's like a secondary thing that...
Yeah, it's an event that Wizards of the North is hosting at the...
The Gauntlet. Which doesn't sound scarier by any means.
Do you guys know that I pay attention sometimes?
I've never seen it.
I work so hard on that.
So yeah, if you guys... If you want to come and bump into us and, you know...
Come say hi!
We do double high fives. We're really good at double high fives. Like the... Two hands up.
Please don't set us up for that. If we fail at that...
Yeah, you don't want to amp it up and then have
somebody I never met in my life is going to be running at me like, ah! And I'm going to be like,
please do that. Just straight up run at Brady and terrify the hell out of him with your hands flailing in the air.
Yeah,
I've seen his reactions. He will not punch you.
But yeah, thanks for listening. This is fun. I love doing the podcast element of this project. It's good to shoot the shit. Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure.
At that point,
give me my glasses back.
Get out of my house. We'll see you guys later. Rogue's Passage Podcast.
Bye.